rehearsal with my equipment for a while. The picture of grace. First heard this song at a guy's house. This was maybe 20 years ago. His name was Boo Boo. That was sort of his nom de plume. And why he bothered, I don't know, because it really. Why I bothered, I don't know. But I was over there quite often, and I had walked in this one night, and there were several people there, one of whom was sitting on the floor with his mouth open at a pair of headphones on, and he was listening to this tune and singing along with it with the consequent sort of mooing that you hear when people are doing that. And it tells you a lot about find these things when I'm working. See, it'll be gone now. If I was Thelonious Monk, I could just go on now for half an hour and have a ball. But I'm stuck with this guy with his mouth open, and I enjoyed what I was hearing is what I'm driving at, which is at least indicates to me how low my standards were back then. And I suspect I'm still that easily amused. I decided I would search out this song and do it sometime. Down, you'll find that it's stranger than known. Signs in the street that say where you're going are somewhere just being their own. Among those afraid of losing their ground, rain gray town, known for its sound, in places small faces unbound. Small faces unbound. laughing, some shapeless form. Thank you. was playing in the Midwest a while ago, and well, now we're not really in the Midwest here, are we? We're sort of. Wherever I was, I'd done the sound check and spent quite a long time doing that, and I was down in the dressing rooms afterwards, and the sound man had gone down there and discovered a piano in one of the rooms, and he'd begun to play, and two things occurred to me. Well, the first one was that he was a much better piano player than he was a sound man, and the second was that he was really, really an extraordinary piano player, somebody like I've rarely heard, who would have had no trouble expanding on that, whatever that was that I was fussing around with. And he was using a scale that, which is as I've later just learned, it was a melodic, ascending melodic minor, with chords like that. Can appreciate if you want to, I listened, and he came up with stuff that was really, for one thing, tortured, and on the other thing, I suppose, brilliant. I was moved by all of this invention and so forth, and he continued to play for maybe half an hour or so. He drew a little crowd down there, and then stopped after a while. And I picked up my guitar, you know, and went back to whatever it was that I was fussing around with, and I thought maybe out of some kind of sour grapes that when that guy knew no one was around, he probably played the Teddy Bear's Picnic and the Dies de Fidelis and The Wayward Wind, which happens to be one of my favorites. It's until recently has only been re-recorded once, and that was by Boxcar Willie. The idea was, and I still kind of subscribe to this, that you just can't be that hip forever. You have to stop sometime. There's a, you know. I'm convinced of that, and I know it's true with some of the players that I know personally, but they just never let it out. You know, Cecil Taylor never plays the Star Spangled Banner in concert. So what I decided was, if that was really true, then I should be able to live up to it myself. So I'd like to play something for you that I love, but that I'm far too hip to be doing. This was I've done this in the past, and the lyrics being the main problem, I've just eliminated them. But in this case, there's not enough melody to support that approach, so I'm going to have to sing these things. Well, there's another one. I'll remember that. That one's... Oh. And you'll learn that these lyrics are just swollen with hope for the future and a kind of glee. So, you know, some of you will be kind of depressed when this is all over. This is written for a wedding by Eddie Reeves and Alex Hart. Somebody says, baby, what you doing? I've been wondering where you've been. Now and then I think about you and me. No use fighting about things we can't recall, 'cause it don't matter now at all. Just come on in, baby, we'll laugh and sing, and we'll make love let the telephone ring. Ring, ring, doorbell ring, come on in, I got Mel Blanc on the radio. I'm glad you came around, I've been feeling down, talking to Tony and Mario. You know they make good conversation, still it ain't no consolation. Cause I got love, baby, I'll give you some. And if somebody comes, let the doorbell ring. Combination grocery store and funeral parlor. And I like to think I got this suit from him. I heard that my friend Michael was coming here, and I know he dresses up for shows, so I thought maybe
thank you.
2 weeks before Eric Dolphy died, somebody asked Miles Davis what he thought of Eric Dolphy, and he said he sounds like when he's playing, he sounds like somebody's standing on his foot. And then Eric Dolphy died, and you know, a lesser man than Miles would have probably been a little disturbed by that, but it didn't really faze him too much. And that bears some oblique connection, at least in Leo's world, and welcome to it, to this next tune. I think Miles' point, if I can find some sort of logical thread here, other than free association, which is, was that Dolphy couldn't play. And this song, a very old song, is about June bugs, or was inspired by them, which are birds. They're birds. They'd like to be, I suppose. They can't fly, the June bugs. They take off all the time, but they can't fly. And you see them, you know, collide eventually with something and then hang there with a foot caught in a screen, or they're squirming on a drape, or they're in somebody's hair, which is, when I was growing familiar with that animal, was always delighted to see. I thought that was great fun. And I lived at the time next door to a woman, a girl, fortune by 14. I hope I was too. I was at least 13, maybe. And I yearned for Patty's embrace, actually. And I just didn't go about it properly. I would. She had a porch swing, and I'd knock on her door. She'd come out and sit on the swing because she wouldn't let me in the house. And I filled the time, which was big and vast and empty, by squashing these June bugs as they squirmed around here and there. And after a few, you know, after I'd visited a few times, I was just hoping they'd land on her, and they never did. I learned later on that that was a pretty feeble form of seduction, to be squashing bugs. The song that was instrumental in ending my career on the trombone, and as a result, I'm really grateful to the author of this tune for what she did for me. It's called Jesus Maria. It was written by Carla Bley. It was one of the first pieces she did, and it's been recorded by Jimmy Giuffre and three or four other people. Jimmy, I call him Jimmy. Jimmy's record is the one I'm familiar with. As far as I know, she herself, Carla, has never recorded this song, which kind of gives you pause when you go to play it yourself. It may be a trap, is what I'm suspecting, but I kind of doubt it. I hope it's not true. Maybe I could invest in a shelf or something. Or one guitar stand might be nice too. When I first heard this, as I mentioned, I was trying to play a trombone. Visiting a lot of much older men down in their basements on weekends who would look at me when I came in the door with kind of a glassy sort of and tell me that for the next hour that my embouchure was horrible and my tone sounded like a snake coming out of something small. And that's one I remember. And then sent me off to state festivals where you were subjected to rooms at least this large that were empty, except for a row of about three or four judges with that same glassy look up on the balcony. And I was the only guy, I'm certain of this, I was the only player that last year on the trombone to make those people laugh. At the time, I was taking my lessons from a guy in Tulsa. Instead of just going, you know, to the other side of town and down in by the boiler room to be abused by some guy with another trombone, I was being driven by a relative about 60 miles into Tulsa, Oklahoma, to go into another basement with a guy who was the bass trombone for the Tulsa Symphony. And he hated me, I think, more than any of the other guys. Because he was the one who, you know, they select the material you perform at these festivals. And it usually is something like the Bluebells of Scotland. That's a biggie. You can hear that all over a campus on these festival days. Or said Londonderry Air was one. And I could have handled either one of those, without too much shame. But this guy made me play a tune called Down Home on the Farm. And the first laugh I got, you know, you had to walk out and with your trombone and introduce your piece. That was the first laugh. And then the second laugh, and that one lasted, was when I started playing the theme of Down Home on the Farm. It was worse than Green Acres. It was worse than... I knew somewhere behind my face that this wasn't for me. But this was, I decided. Thank you. many people did I? Maybe I. I'm trying to remember if I brought this. Every time I get I mention a trombone, I'm in danger of repeating a. Another. It wasn't just the teachers and the that got me that drove me away from that instrument. How many people here have killed a chicken in their? It must be. I mean, we're not that far away from the Midwest, but yeah. There's a. I'll try to be brief. The reason I'm stammering is that I know I'm about to be unbrief, and it's kind of given me a little quiver of shiver of tremor of. Right, because I've told myself that I would edit my mouth in the future, but it's really only because of one woman who was yelling at me in Columbia, North Carolina, from the foot of the stage. She was yelling, "We didn't come to hear you talk, ha ha ha," things like that, you know. Truth in that invective, but I wish you were here tonight. I got to the trombone because I wanted to play the flute, and that was my first introduction to the first level of this sort of, I don't know what to call it, infrastructure, this hidden system that supports the teaching of young kids on their instruments. There's a whole life out there that people are unaware of unless they've had this experience, unless their parents handed them a violin and said, "Here." The first one of these people, or the first level of this, is the guy who drives around, or maybe he's, I think he could be obsolete by now, but I'm not sure. Drives around with a truck full of stop me if, you know, please stop me. And just say, "We didn't come to hear you talk." A truck full of instruments. But these are instruments that you saw behind Abraham Lincoln in those pictures of, you know, Appomattox or wherever he was. And they've turned green in the interim with this impenetrable scale of green. I've always wondered what that was. And I also wondered, even as a child, if why you couldn't expect that what was inside the instrument would be even a little worse than what was the outside of it. Because these people would bring these instruments into the grade schools and lay them out, again, usually down in a basement somewhere. I've checked this out. On a tabletop, you know, next to the boiler, that room with the scale on the, another sort of, you know, calcium on the walls and the bricks popping out. And then they'd expect children to come in there and see them. And, you know, two or three would usually, and I was one of them, and we were in Cheyenne at the time, and they were laid out on the table, and the idea was if you could play one, not play it, but if you could make a sound on one, any instrument, any one you wanted, you could take it home with you for maybe a year. The idea being that all these other guys who are lined up behind the fellow you're talking to would then have some work in the future. I should add that this is a great moment for me and the other two people who walked in to try an instrument. It wasn't loaded with cynicism, so I said, "I want to play the flute," and he looked at me like I've never heard that from somebody in Wyoming, and he handed me the flute, and I made a sound, but it was sort of the equivalent of the sound of foam. Instead of, you know, anything resembling a flute, and he said, "Your mouth is too big," and he gave me a trombone, and I believed him. You know, I thought, well, and I played the trombone for 9 years, so we can figure either that it takes me 9 years to get a joke, or that I'm very easily led. It's probably both. And that's it. Once you've got the instrument, that you're kind of stuck, because there's that ethos that says if you're playing it, you got to play it right, and you're not going to put it down until you do. And they've loaned this to us, and so go practice, and that's it. Then the next thing that happens is you're drawn into a junior high school band or a grade school band, and asked to play again. This not Londonderry Air now, but something like the Dam Busters, which is about a dam that was blown, the Ruhr, I think, or some such thing. You learn many years later that it didn't really blow up either. It's just another disappointment, you know. And so you go into a room and you play with all these other people who have varying levels of commitment to their instrument. And if you're really a dink, if all you do is make trouble and goof off and get in the, you know, conductor's face and just, you know, be sort of a huckleberry kind of crank, then your instrument, whatever it is taken away from you and you're handed a punishment instrument. In our band, there were three of them, and the worst, supposedly, was the tuba. But if you think about this, if you're a troublemaker and you're always, you know, creating a stink, why would you give that person a tuba? It's not, you know, not smart. The other one is the euphonium, which is a thing that looks like a baby with its mouth open. And in our band, the E-flat clarinet, that's unusual. There are very few of them in existence to begin with. But it's a thing, I don't remember, but it's very small. It's like a peewee clarinet, and it has a reed like this. It's like forcing air through a screwdriver when you try to play it. I was in a direct line of sight with the E-flat clarinet victim. So I got to watch him blow the back of his head off every day for years and years. Years, it was months. He was an albino guy. We call him White Ear. And I mention that only because I'd like to indicate the muted sensibility for metaphor that exists in these bands. One day, Roger, that was his name, as he kept telling us, came up to me and said, how'd you like to come out to the farm for the weekend? He evidently thought we'd developed a relationship, you know, as a result of all of this. And I said, no, I don't want to go to a farm. But for reasons that are clouded now in the, you know, by the lack of total recall, I did go, and I went out there, and it was what, and this was now, we had moved to Oklahoma, and in that state, 4-H movies were shown at least twice a year to the student body of the state, and you knew as a result that nothing went on at a farm other than hard work and people who smiled all the time, that's what it was. We labored and labored, and that seemed to be Roger's form of entertainment. We tied hay bales to the back of a truck and towed them through this sort of brown, wasted oblivion and watched them disintegrate. And then cattle appeared from literally nowhere and ate what had scattered on the ground. Entertainments like that. And as we got to be around, you know, dawn, and we came back to the farmhouse, and I think Roger had decided that either I wasn't having any fun or he wasn't having enough fun, because he said, how would you like to kill a chicken? And I said, sure, that'd be great. Now we were surrounded by chickens at this point. These chickens have seen Roger or somebody in his family come into their midst day in and day out and kill one of them. But there they are, just jillions of chickens at our feet. sort of, you know, trying to get our attention. Now, I thought we would use the approach I was familiar with was an axe. And I thought, you know, I didn't think much about it at all, actually. But Roger reached down and he selected one of these volunteers at his feet and started swinging it around by like this. And he gave it a little twink, and that was the end of the chicken. The whole idea of that was to show me how it's done, and as if I couldn't kill a chicken without knowing how to do that. I was a little arrogant at the time, as I soon discovered, because I selected my applicant down here. And by the way, now they don't have the excuse of saying, well, it's been 24 hours, I forgot. They just saw one of them die. So I grabbed one, twirled over my head, and gave it a little yank, and nothing happened other than the bird got furious with me. And I thought, well, my heart really wasn't in that one, and I thought it was easier than that, so I tried and nothing happened, and I tried and nothing happened, and I did that, seemed like forever. It took on a sort of existential kind of glow as I stood there with this bird. And Roger said, well, why don't you let go of its head, take hold of its feet, and beat it up against the side of the chicken coop. Now, that sounded appealing to me, actually. So, but it's like those dreams when your feet are stuck and you can't run and you have to run. There's only this much real chicken. The rest is feathers. And not even a chicken will volunteer to be throttled. Will leave its head out as a building is approaching it. So you're doing another move that just keeps repeating and repeating and repeating. This is humiliating stuff. And so finally, Roger said, well, why don't you hold it down and I'll back the tractor over its head over here. Well, it didn't stop there because the tread on a tractor tire is like this. And we succeeded in just sort of pinning the bird to the dirt. Didn't hurt it a bit. So we just walked away at that point, and I decided if that's what a clarinet does to you, what would a trombone do to you? So I discovered the guitar that year. Probably died of boredom in the dark down there after a while. The end of the things here with a couple more. Wait a minute. Is that right? Yeah. This is a song that's out on my new record. My labels have asked me for years, please, you know, tell people that you have something for sale. And then they would, you know, insist and then kick me off, you know, when I didn't do it. And I always thought it was a little like asking for spare change, you know, to say, well, I have a new record out and I'm sure you'd love it if you. But I'm, you know, I've come to see their point now. And so this new record I heard on the radio, I was driving from one job to the next in New Mexico when the tune was over with, the disc jockey came on the air and he said, a lot of people don't like that song. Well, did that need to be said is what I wondered. And I guess I can understand why that would be, but they're kind of missing the point if they do hate it. This is my kind of optimism. Every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed and you crawl out of bed and you crawl out of bed. Every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed and you look out the moon where the window is and the stars shine and the stars shine and the stars shine. Every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. Down below in the sun belt and the telephones and the telephones and the telephones, you look out the moon where the window is every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. And some of us breathe in the brown ground where the worms clown, where the worms clown, where the worms clown. Way down below in the sun belt, every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. And every night when you lay down, you fall flat, you fall flat, you fall flat. And some of us breathe in the brown ground every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. And we're all asleep in the same dream in a snort fort, in a snort fort, in a snort fort. Every night when you lay down, every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. Modified snow peas and the sunroofs and the sunroofs and the sunroofs. We're all asleep in the same dream every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of it. If you look in the mirror, it's your father's face and the thin grin and the thin grin and the thin grin. Santa Claus pulling up snow peas every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl. There's tears in the bank and a credit card in the backyard, in the backyard, in the backyard. If you look in the mirror, it's your father's face every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. And once in a while, when the wind blows and the heart whines and the heart whines and the heart whines, there's tears in the bank and a credit card every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. In the pocket or a breath mint or a car key or a car key or a car key. Once in a while when the wind blows every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. And your kid has a face like a walnut from the ice cream, from the ice cream, from the ice cream. And there's lint in your pocket or a breath mint every day in the morning when you get up. Every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. Every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed.
Thank you.
thank you for coming. It's a pleasure to be back here. I hope to see you next year. Thanks a lot. Good night. Thing happens is as a result of never changing your strings, they tend to develop varying levels of crud on them, and so they expand and contract at different rates according to how warm they are.